Welcome back to the big issue discussing the outcomes of the CDD survey, post-election survey. Very interesting, where 62% of Ghanaians interviewed say they do not have confidence in the ability of the president to protect the country's financial resources and curb corruption in the next 4 years. Now, this is a particularly interesting discovery or revelation because of the nature of our politics and the history of the president when it comes to politics and what he has said he will do and what his government will do. So I've been discussing this with Mavis Supok-Dome, a research analyst from the CDD Ghana. The Member of Parliament for Tamale North is here. He's here to speak. You'll just hear from him. Franklin Kujo, President of Imani Africa, is also here. As is the Member of Parliament for Nshayaso, the Honorable Stephen Amwa. You can also be part of the conversation via our WhatsApp line 0549-986-996, 0549-986-996, or 0550-58-5832, 0550-58-5832. You can also reach us on Twitter at CT973 with the hashtag TheBigIssue to share your thoughts on what you've heard so far on the show. So, Honorable Suhini, you've heard from the agency that the think tank that did the survey and the motivations behind it and what they discovered, the kind of questions they asked, the demographics. You've heard from Franklin as well. And then you've heard from Honorable Amor, who basically says it's time we reframe the conversation around perception and corruption. He understands that there is corruption, but the inherent intentions of Ghanaians. Basically, he says, we are overly politicized. So if you met 10 Ghanaians and spoke to 7, MPP, NDC, so their views would be tainted by their political affiliation.
That's quite interesting. I wonder how the researchers coincidentally only meet more NDC people or more MPP people, depending on the time zones. Because in the past, when they met, when they suggested that President Mahama was the government was corrupt in their research work, this analogy would have meant that they met more MPP people. Mm. Do you get the point? Mm. And now that they are saying President Akufo-Addo is more corrupt, then it's as if they have met more NDC people. You know, I mean, if you are to go by his analogy, that is what it seems. And it is quite strange that the researchers will be meeting, you know, NDC people more when MPP is in government.
He does not trust the
I get that. I get that. But let me just say good morning to Franklin, good morning to Mavis, and good morning to my brother, Stephen, and to you, and to the very good people of the Tamale North constituency. I will start by just putting something that Sticker said, which I describe as the NPP's claim to fame when it comes to how better they are in terms of fighting against corruption. The fact that no NPP person has ever been jailed. Mm. That is said without the context. You know, we have followed prosecutions in the past, and those prosecutions, I mean, both parties have had members being prosecuted for corruption. In some cases, we have had situations where judicial complicities have come up. For example, Chacho Chikata, and how he came out of jail as a result of a pardon and challenged even the verdict, and was eventually vindicated that he shouldn't have been imprisoned. So you cannot rule out the judicial complicities in why maybe some people have been jailed and others have not been jailed. You cannot also rule out the revelation by Kwame Nahor in his book after some investigations were done and prosecutions were going to be made. The president of the day, Professor Mills, God bless his soul, decided not to go ahead with the prosecutions because of his father for all mantra. You can't rule out the attitude of the two political parties in this when it comes to such prosecutions. But what is also critical is that the NDC has to be given credit for being the only political party that has prosecuted its own appointees or former appointees. It has never happened under the NPP. They don't lift a finger against their appointees. It's not under Kufuor, not under Nana Akufo-Addo. In fact, under President Kufuor, he actually even said...
House Minister, that was jailed under Kufuor.
He wasn't MPP. He was a PNC man. In fact, President Kufuor is on record to have said that he will not prosecute his people to bring his government down. He said that publicly. You know, so that is a record that the NDC also has. And that shows a level of seriousness when it comes to dealing with corruption, because they say that you should pluck the log in your eye before you can point to others. And so that has to be settled. But I enjoy Sticker and his sermons, you know, when especially the New Patriotic Party has his back on the ropes. I enjoy the sermons he gives, because apart from the extremes, obviously, it is true that corruption is so endemic in this country, and it also even expresses itself in how dishonest we can be about situations that we are confronted with. And it is the reason why, if you look at history, every government in this country have been removed either through the ballot or through the barrel of the gun as a result of corruption. Yet the people who take over eventually also lose out because of corruption. And who are the people who get into government? They don't come from Mars. They don't come from space. They come from amongst us. So every time we are, you know, so upset with corruption, and it's reflected in the survey where it is said that about 61% or so.
62.
No, I'm talking about the percentage, 67%. Think that the only way to punish corrupt acts of government is to vote them out. Mm-hmm. When it comes to those who will speak out to condemn, it's only about 49%. So sometimes you may not even hear the loud criticisms and condemnations, because 49% think that you should speak out and condemn it, but 67% thinks that you should vote them out. And that is a reflection of how we have always behaved over the years. When we are fed up with corruption, we don't look into ourselves and see how we have contributed to it. We think the solution is just to vote a government out and vote, you know, a party in. And that also turns out to be even more corrupt. So on that basis, I understand the point Sticker is making, except to say that in opposition, he didn't think this way. He didn't think that the parameters needed to change. And that is also another level of dishonesty. In fact, he was one of the loudest, you know, trumpeters of how corrupt, you know, the regime was, based on research work such as this. And that also points to a certain level of dishonesty that I speak of. So clearly, we have a long way to go as a people when it comes to fighting against corruption. And it is even more disappointing that we had the opportunity with the NPP coming into office with a man who was touted to be, you know, a champion against corruption, and who was old enough not to want anything, you know, but the right things being done. It is so disappointing that under him we are still getting the results that the CDD has, you know, come up with as a result of the research that they carried out. But when I say it is disappointing, it maybe I'm speaking in terms of the larger majority, but to some of us it is not really disappointing. It's actually vindication, you know, because check, if you can go and check my statements as far as 2017, when the president made his inaugural speech, and it may be basic, but you see, when we compare ourselves to the developed countries, we need to understand that they take some of these basic things seriously, and that is how they are able to manage the major things. And it is even biblical that if you do not manage, you know, little things well, you can't be entrusted with bigger things. So during the inaugural speech, when it turned out that the speech was stolen, and not even a word of apology or something came from the president, I made my conclusion that this was not a man you could trust. fight corruption. He couldn't be honest. And so I predicted that he was not going to succeed in the fight against corruption. It could be that basic. But you see, intellectual dishonesty is so huge. And my researchers who are here know what it means to engage in plagiarism. So I think that a little remorse from the president would have given me some hope that, okay, this is a man who actually means well. But I made that prediction that based on that, I did not see him, you know, standing up and admitting to wrong in his government and giving hope that better things was going to happen. But so I'm not surprised.
Not by his actions. You said that was basic for you, but his subsequent actions with passing the RTI, Steka says it might be little, but at least he moved the needle. The office of the special prosecutor increasing monies paid to these agencies. His actions have spoken for him, have they not?
What has been the impact of those actions? The RTI, you pointed out, its implementation is engulfed in difficulties in terms of charges and fees. In fact, even when we passed the RTI, we had to postpone the implementation because we said we were going to put some measures in place. The implementation date came and we're not ready. You know, so what is the impact? The special prosecutor, what has been the impact of that office? The man who was touted to be his friend, the man who tasted water and was tasting wine with Nanado, concluded that Nanado is the mother serpent of corruption and left that office. So what has been the impact of those actions? You know, and I say he tasted water and wine because he was with the NDC and said the NDC was corrupt, and then became a friend of Nanado because he didn't like corruption, and in the end has concluded that Nanado is a mother serpent of corruption. So he tasted the NDC, if it was corrupt, corruption, and has tasted the MPP, corruption, and has concluded that he's the mother serpent and has regretted his every action. So what has been the impact of those actions? If it is, you know, increased allocations to institutions that are set up to fight corruption, check our budgetary allocations. It has always increased. It has always increased. It has never gone down. No government in office has ever reduced the allocations to those offices.
Maybe the focus but then again,
what has been the output? The Auditor General that was touted to be one of the best Ghana has ever had, what happened to him? He was hounded out of office by the same president who recently was so proud of his deeds that he was teasing him. The president that we thought we could hang our hopes when it comes to fighting against corruption on doesn't see anything wrong with what is happening to the institutions that he claims he has resourced. Was he resourcing those institutions so they would do his bidding? Because clearly, in the case of the Auditor General, it is as if he refused to do his bidding, and that is why he has to get him out of office. And so for some of us, it is vindication. I mean, the CDD has been very economical with their wares. I was reading through the report, and for example, they say less than half are optimistic. Less than half. Clearly, what it says is that majority of Ghanaians, you know, do not have confidence in Nana Akufo-Addo. 55%. Majority, 55. But you see, it is so cleverly written, less than half of the... So you know, it is good language. I like it. But the point is that majority of Ghanaians, 55%, can't trust this government. And then, you know, if you look at...
But they are not allowed the room of...
Oh, majority of Ghanaians is not political language.
No,
they were very careful. Even with their report, they were very careful, you know, about that report. And that makes me wonder sometimes. But that's just by the way. But you see, if you look at the period...
So that is unfair.
No. I didn't tell you what I'm wondering about. So what are you suggesting is unfair?
You've said it.
The point is, the numbers
are what matters.
No, I like the language. In fact, I'm not criticizing the language.
Categorical about 2%.
I am not criticizing. I don't get this. I have said nothing.
I have said nothing.
It's for you to do.
Charles.
All I'm saying is that.
Anorama.
All I'm saying is that. Can I continue? I beg you. I don't think I will let you come in,
Honorable Amoa. Don't worry. I'll let you come in.
No, please. I don't think it is fair. I don't think it is fair.
I don't think it is fair.
You are interrupting my chain of thoughts.
Honorable Amoa.
You are interrupting my chain of thoughts.
Let's have some decorum here. I'll give you a rebuttal. Don't worry.
I didn't interrupt.
Just note what you want to say. I'll give you a rebuttal. Don't worry at all.
You know, so.
Let's not speak across each other.
So I'm saying that I like the language. I am not in any way criticizing them for that. I'm just making the point that if you don't look at it critically, you know, it doesn't jump out at you. You know, the fact that 55%, you know, of respondents do not have, you know, confidence in the president's, you know, fight against corruption and managing the finances of this country. And for me, it is interesting if you look at the period of the survey, and maybe that's the point I was going to make. But because you were thinking something else that I wasn't saying, you interrupted. In fact, I was actually talking about the elections. We had just come out of an election that they won, and then you have this report, 55%, 62% do not trust that the president can fight corruption. You know, 61%, another vindication. Do not even believe in the 1 million one constituency. I mean, 57% are not confident in 1D, 1F. 3 out of 10 Ghanaians actually believe that the government is, 3 out of 10 do not trust the government when it comes to corruption. 3 out of 10 Ghanaians. This is just after an election they won. It just makes me wonder. You know, whether really, as some of us challenged, the results were really what they were supposed to be. Because it just makes you wonder that immediately after an election, a government gets this verdict through, you know, a scientific research, where majority of Ghanaians do not think that, you know, they can be trusted in these areas. And the same number of people, 67% of them, think that the way to punish a government that is has this character is to vote them out. It just makes you wonder the outcome of our results and who are those who really voted for this party to still be in power. That's the point that I sought to make earlier about wondering. Mm-hmm. It just makes you wonder. I mean, immediately after an election, you get this result. 3 out of 10 Ghanaians, you know, about 7 out of 10 do not trust the government. 57% have lost confidence in the 1D1F. 61% 1 million one constituency they think is a sham. I mean, 53% do not think they can protect our finances. 62% do not trust the president to fight corruption. And all of these people say the way to punish a government with that character is to vote them out. 67% think the way to punish a government is to vote them out. So it makes you wonder, then who voted them in 3 months earlier, before this research was done?
Maybe that also then goes to explain the point Amoa is making, it goes down to being overly political then.
Yeah, but
when it comes to an election, any people will close his eyes and say MPP, NDC will say NDC. That goes down to make the point Amoa is making, that's a fair point to make.
But it doesn't explain the 67% who thinks that the best way to punish the government is to vote it out. You know, it doesn't explain it. And maybe for some, that's why I say vindication. Maybe that's another reason why we went to court. But we are law abiding, and so we take it as it is. But I think that I am also happy that less than, you know, majority of people have confidence in the government when it comes to improving and doing much better. Because clearly the signs on the wall show that we are not going to see any improvement. It is sad that we have to live with it, you know, for about 2-3 years more. It is sad. Mm-hmm. But it is disturbing that people do not have confidence. And it is even more disturbing that the government and the president and vice do not even seem to appreciate the level of despondency among Ghanaians. And for people who, you know, love democracy, that should be something we should all be worried about. If you have people this despondent and a government so unperturbed about that level of despondency, you know, you should be worried about what can happen, even though we all pray against it. And we think that we must be patient enough and support the government in whatever way we can until, you know, we reach an election where the about 67% will now be bold enough to cast their votes against it. I think that's what we should be doing. We should not ignore the threat, however, but we should be patient so that we get there. Because clearly, when you look at the attitude of the president, his vice president, and the appointees, they do not appreciate, you know, the level of despondency and the level of mistrust. From day one, I kept talking about how this government was not just incompetent, but was also dishonest. And that dishonesty is offensive, because when people know what they know and you still want to act smart, it tends to be offensive to the average Ghanaian. So I think that perhaps they should study this report, and hopefully they can make some amends. I don't see how they will succeed at that, but at least some attempts should be made. But when you listen to them again, you don't get inspired. For example, when you spoke to Peter McMenu, when you spoke to Peter McMenu, and then Steka also started, they think COVID is their crisis that they can hang on to. So everybody should go and be discussing COVID and talk about COVID. That's the solution to all the problems that they have created in the last 4 years. The issues of corruption, the issues of public finance management did not just come up as a result of COVID. And even with corruption in the management of COVID, we the people see the corruption. And so you just don't sit back and think that your solution to every problem in this country now is to point at COVID.
Okay, points well made. I'll just do one final run quickly on this, and then we can close this conversation and move on to the second one.
Come on, Zoom. Let me respond.
Yes. Stephen, go ahead. I'll give you 3 minutes, and then I'll come back in studio to Franklin and Mavis to wrap up.
Can I speak now?
Yes, you can.
Can I speak now?
Yes.
I'm so shocked. Boss, can you do something for me?
What do you want
can
me to
you
do for
pick,
you?
Can you pick all the performance parameters that Nanado's government took over 2016 and compare them to what is happening today? Even let's put COVID aside.
Mm-hmm.
Let's be honest with ourselves. From the economy through even infrastructure, agriculture, education, pro-poor policies. I think if we want to do politics, any honest, God-fearing person will not vote for NDC against MPP, unless the person is suffering from unconscious incompetence.
But, brother, that is not what the survey says, does it?
I'm coming. No, the things you were saying were the things the survey said. So what? Please let me also speak.
No, but there were things born out of
But he was alluding to the fact that Boss, you are not being fair with me. You allow him to speak. Can you allow me to also speak?
Well, I'll let you speak when the conversation is aligned properly.
But he said so many things that the survey never pointed.
No, if but you made inferences based away. On the service numbers.
Which numbers? He talked about the economy. 2016, our inflation rate was about 16.4, thereabout. Now, is it not about 7.8?
Talk about the economy.
Policy rate. Well, because he spoke about the economy.
Yeah, but he did not talk about those aspects of the economy.
But boss, what you are doing is not fair. Somebody said that the confidence of Ghanaians in the area of fighting corruption and the economy of financing. So when we talk about financial economy, what is it?
That's zero.
And he said that we are saying that the underperformance is solely because of the COVID. And I'm giving comparative figures from the time we took over to show to him and Ghanaians that it's not just only about the COVID. Even if it's the COVID, we are better than that. And I'm listening to them. He said, I shouldn't speak about what should I say?
No, the point he was making was that the response of the NPP to this particular survey has been COVID. And that it seems to be the response to every criticism that comes the government's way, when it comes to how it does, it handles everything.
So
it was a response in relation to this.
No.
Mr. McMenu even raised this in response to the survey.
Boss, what you are doing is not fair. He says so many things. I'm like, if you don't want me to speak, fine. He even went further saying that me, when I was in opposition, based the same perception, I was against. And this is blatant lies. At least they have been jailed by courts of competent jurisdiction before. So we have proven record to say that they are corrupt with evidence. That is all that I'm saying. But allow me to speak. I beg you.
No, I will allow you to speak based on the parameters I have in front of me.
Listen,
based on what you want to say.
It's not what I want to say.
Okay.
The confidence of Ghanaians, they stated two areas, fighting corruption and the economy of this country, financing. So what I'm saying is not about economy. I spoke about corruption. This time I'm speaking about the fact that even if it's financial or economic issues, even with the economy or without the economy, we've done better than them. And I think this is a very cogent discussion. Unless you don't want me to speak.
Go ahead, sir.
And I'm saying that. And Ananado Dankwa, he took over this country in 2016. All the primary and secondary macro indicators of our economy, about 90% of them, he has done better, even with the economy. And I'm giving you figures to know that when it comes to finance and the economy, the perception of the people to me cannot be better than the reality and the data we have. And you are saying I can't speak to it, so what do you want me to say? What do you want me to say? Hello?
I'm listening to you, Sika.
Yes. So I am saying that Honorable Suhini talking about we putting everything on or blaming everything on COVID. If we say, okay, let's take COVID, there was no even COVID. The best way we can appraise Nanado's government is to pick these parameters, whether corruption or even economy or financing or whatever, and compare. And I think any honest, objective person will understand where I'm coming from.
Okay.
That if they are right to say it's COVID, fine. The policy rate, which is the government or interest rate in 2016, is even higher than present lending rate from 25.5. Now, what do we have? Reduced over 1,000 basis points. T-bills that we know the performance is strongly linked to the economy from about 22.5 per annum now to about 13.5. Even debt they are talking about. NDC increase between 2012 and 2016 increased Ghana's debt portfolio over 230-40%. Nanado's own is about 140%. Even with the COVID, where we're not getting revenue and we have to rely on debt to finance our obligations. This is what I'm talking about. And if you think this is not important, that's fine. Because I'm speaking based on what he said. And I want you as a media man to pick these bases and do comparisons if the NDC wants us to go this way. I'm not saying Ghana is okay. Well, but anybody that thinks productivity on hold does not affect the economy, does not affect our financing, does not affect completion of our projects, does not even affect most of the issues we are raising in corruption, then I don't know what the person wants to talk about.
Okay.
And this is my point.
Let's do this, Honorable Amoah. This is even a conversation we are going to delve in the next 5 minutes. So just hold on for me and let me wrap up this conversation. And then we can actually do the economy breakdown as you actually want. Is that okay?
No, I want. Yeah. No, please.
Hold on.
What you are doing is so unfair to me. So he raised a lot of issues and I'm responding. And you're saying,
I'm giving everybody 3 minutes on this line. I gave you 5 minutes.
No, you don't do that.
Don't worry, Anabola. Stay on for me.
You know, Godfrey.
Godfrey.
Let me go to Mavis.
Godfrey, let me come in just so that you can wrap up clean. You know, Sika is amazing. He started and spoke at length. Nobody interrupted him. Now he has forgotten that he started speaking.
Don't worry about that.
And my, you know, rebuttal is what he's now focused on. But that's just by the way. He talks about comparing performance indicators. And I'm happy you have reminded him that our next discussion is going to be on the economy. That is where we can go into, you know, the economic.
So
wait
for me.
No, wait a minute. The economic indicators. But when he talks about performance indicators, relative to the topic we are discussing, the topic corruption, the performance indicators are what is before us by the CDD. Those are the indicators, and the indicators show that, you know, 62% of Ghanaians think that the president and his government are corrupt. Again, Transparency International over the period has established the record that the NPP again is perceived to be the most corrupt in government. The NPP under Nana Akufo-Addo and Dr. Bawumia is perceived to be the most corrupt, and the records are there to show from 2013 when they shouted on the rooftops that Ghana was, you know, being, you know, finished by corruption. I can't get a better word. Finished by corruption. According to the Transparency International, we're performing at 46%. 46%. In 2014, we're performing at 48%. According to the Transparency International, that's when they were shouting the loudest about corruption. We performed the lowest, 43%, in 2016. Yes. Guess what? Since they have been into office, their best performance was in 2020, the 43%, which was our lowest performance in 2016. Because in 2017, they performed at 40%, 2018, 41%, 2019, 41%, 2020, 43%. But the time they were shouting loudest about corruption, we were performing at 46% and 48%.
Okay, point well made.
That's the record.
Mavis, let's wrap this up. So, Honorable Amoah does make a very interesting point about the nature of Ghanaians and basically the validity of questions, of answers to the questions that you will pose. And so it might affect the outcome. And so he is suggesting a new paradigm for research. What are your thoughts on that particular point he made?
What would be the paradigm, particularly when it comes to public opinion surveys? In the first place, as human beings, what we hear and what we see inform our thoughts and feelings. So if what we see inform our thoughts and opinions about issues, then what we see and here should be good. Okay. So we vote various governments into power and expect development, expect good governance. And we see, contrary to those things, we are not satisfied with those, how they have, successive governments have performed. Just recently, we have fixed the country issues in the social media when people were campaigning, fix the country. Why were Ghanaians taking to social media to fix the country? Because they were not happy about how successive governments have handled development and governance issues in their country. So this is not about a particular political party, whether NDC or MPP. It's about how Ghanaians see issues or I felt. I am in a community. A particular government have started maybe a clinic or a school, and it doesn't go anywhere. And I hear so many stories about it. What will inform? I need my child to go to school, and yet I see politicians living a good life, and my child cannot go to school. Where did they get the money? When I go to the market, you come and pay. You come and take tolls from me, market tolls from me. But where do you get the money to ride in cars? And my child cannot get to go to school. And I hear a story about corruption. Why wouldn't I believe it? If you think it's just stories, why wouldn't I believe that story? Why will I not believe that story? Now, when this survey indicates that Ghanaians are ready to punish politicians, it doesn't matter whether it's NDC or MPP, they are ready to punish. So we'll vote you out. We'll vote you out.
I think that's reflected in what we saw with the MPs.
Exactly. I was just going there. One, they'll vote them out. First, our previous surveys did not show so much interest in demonstrations. But look at this current survey shows that a lot, 40-something percent are saying that they'll go. About 43% said they will not take to demonstrations. About 40% say they will not take to demonstrations. They will demonstrate to protest their unhappiness. But in our previous surveys, they didn't show that. So that means there's increasing agitation over what is happening. And 2020 election really clearly shows that Ghanaians are ready to vote people based on performance. The vote reduction shows it, because the chief issues that they mentioned were performance actions and actions of the government, right? Why did the MPP lose seats? The same thing. It was based on performance, chiefly performance. So if so, and it's not just when they say performance, even that one particular one, the government side, they even mentioned an appointment, ministerial and DCEs. So it's not just about the president himself that they are looking at, but also the whole governance structure, from up to the bottom. They see what is happening within the district. They see what is happening within their district that they live in. And they see what is happening within their region. And they see what is happening within the country. And CDC surveys do not look at a political affiliation in doing that. We used a national representative sample. So this is telling you that Ghanaians are getting, they in there are getting more informed about issues and are voting on base those lines. So it is up to politicians to rather concentrate and work. What do Ghanaians expect? They expect a politician who shows integrity in their work, who works, take accountability in their actions, and are competent and honest, right? And they have punished or put Ghana in a situation of a hung parliament in hopes that executive can be put in check. So we have to look at this survey results so closely, and we'll see a lot of things that we can pick.
They can make readings from
Exactly.
Thank you very much, Mavis Zupok Dome. I'll give Franklin final words on this, and then we'll take a
Well, listening to Sticker presupposes that these surveys are just like market surveys, where irrespective of the question asked about a product, somebody will say, well, it's a great product anyway. I don't think that is what the intentions of persons who were surveyed actually is. I think it's more of a reflection of what they believe they are experiencing. And as I said, it takes a lot for people to make those confirmatory, give confirmatory results. Yes, it may be perceived as being because of their political, antenna at a particular point in time. But there's something that is feeding that, which maybe has alluded to significantly. And I think before we sort of question the motives of the researchers, I think it's important to step back a bit and also look at previous results. I mean, as Mavis has mentioned, the elections, the 2020 elections, for instance. And I think Stephen references why maybe was it Honorable Sweeney that was suggesting that if it was 63% disapproval, how come the elections showed otherwise? So possibly, again, maybe what Stephen was talking about could be at play. But I don't think that is the case. I suspect the reasons why MPs were disproportionately punished was also because they interface a lot with the people. They are closer. And somehow, some of us have also believed that the president, still has some significant goodwill, which may have endeared him to the citizenry. So the point I'm making is, depending on the point in time these polls and these surveys are conducted, the actions or the inactions of political actors actually largely contribute to the results. So we should see these as mirroring what people believe governance and the impact of governance is about, but not necessarily because it may just be partisan, and I don't think that's fair.
All right, then. Thank you very much, Franklin. We'll take another break. When we return, we'll shift our attention to the economy, Ghana's fiscal economy, as we look at what some have described as an economy that is in a problematic state. The government disagrees, of course, with that particular description. But when we return, that conversation will happen. The Big Issue, we'll be right back.
Monsieur, Et voilà.
Ah, babe, what is this?
This is the escargot and the foie gras. Oui.
Where did she go?
You pa one casa un huse or base or pay fee again.
It's been long since you ever felt like this.
Welcome to the best in Ghanaian entertainment on Akwaba Magic. Welcome home to Akwaba Magic on DSTV channel 150. It's your moment. DSTV.
The conversations that help you shape your spiritual journey as a Christian. Find the answers you seek. Catch the 700 Club with Pat Robertson every Sunday morning at 8:30 a.m. on City TV.
For an all-new season of Big Brother Niger on GoTV. Rated 18. Proudly sponsored by ABEG and associate sponsor Patricia.
And I ask the Lord, one name fits you. And he said, yeah.
Turn your worries into worship and watch God transform your battles into blessings. Generation. My name is Eden Albright Davis.
Generation, keep praising you, yet no word sums you up.
The past year has been difficult, and I know that many people, perhaps including you, may have had their faith challenged. Allow me to lead you into the comfort and presence of God through worship. Stay tuned to CCTV for adoration. And experience the awesome power of God's presence as we ascribe glory to His name. The rhythms of your heartbeat, pulse, and breath, all in praise of our miraculous God.
You're the hallowed one. You're the hallowed one. You're the holy one.
Adoration, showing every Sunday at 7 a.m. and 6 p.m. only on City TV.
Welcome back to The Big Issue as we now delve into the assessment of Ghana's fiscal economy. This was done by the Institute of Fiscal Studies. And basically, a lot of conversations have come up this week that revolve around the Ghanaian economy. So it was quite topical and coincidental that the IFS also decided to do an analysis of Ghana's fiscal economy. And they basically have said that the economy is in a problematic state. Now, they attribute this to government's inability to mobilize adequate revenue, disregard for expenditure management, overspending, and engaging in extra budgetary fiscal activities. Now, they also even go further and say the government has performed poorly for the past 8 years. And this is something that Honorable Stephen Amwa will respond to. He's already started doing that at the first part of the show. And IFS also says that the average growth rate of total government revenue and grants has fallen sharply, both in nominal and real terms. So I'm just looking through the presentation that the IFS did this week, you know, and I'll give you some highlights on that, on revenue, on expenditure. So for instance, on revenue, it says that the government has performed poorly for the past 8 years, as the average growth rate of total government revenue and grants has fallen sharply in both nominal and real terms. In fact, for the past 8 years, real growth of total revenue and gross has fallen below real GDP growth. On expenditure, it says that currently two expenditure items more than consume the entire government revenue. We'll get details on that. It says in addition to the two expenditure items, the government has other spending obligations, which is transfers to statutory funds, purchases of goods and services, capital expenditure, and arrears clearance. And then it also goes on to break down extra budgetary fiscal activities. Also says that the debt to GDP ratio has increased by as large as 33.4 percentage points in just 7 years. And then also that Ghana's high cost of borrowing plus low revenue mobilization explains its high interest burden. And then goes on to explain that, in fact, they say that Ghana has the third highest interest payment burden among 118 countries in the world, with available data in the WDI database from 2018. So I'll try and get some more detail on this. I've been joined by Dr. Edu Susako. He is an economist with the University of Ghana Business School. He's an economics lecturer and also part of the IFS group that puts this together. Dr. Sakode, good morning.
Good morning. I'm from the Department of Economics.
The Department of Economics. Yes. And I'm Steve Namwa, are you still with us?
Yes, I am.
Okay, so let's talk some numbers now. So I will give first say on this to Dr. Sakode, then I'll come to you.
Are you aware I'm at a conference?
I think you can handle that with my producer whilst I deal with...
Okay, sure.
I will deal with Dr. Sakode. So, Dr. Sakode, why should we be bothered by this? The government paints a picture that is quite different from what the IFS and yourself have put out. You are saying that the economy is in a problematic state. If we listen to the finance minister, we should be very happy and satisfied with where we are right now.
Well, the economy has different sectors or different branches that you want to look at to assess the health of every economy. Mm. What this research concentrated on is on the fiscal side. Mm. And the figures that we picked for the research are from the budget, from the Ministry of Finance. We didn't generate the figures ourselves. These figures were generated by Ministry of Finance, Bank of Ghana, Ghana Statistical Service. These are the institutions that generate data for macroeconomic analysis. So the fiscal position is very bad as we speak. You mentioned some of the numbers, and I think to start with, let's see, revenue.
Yes, on revenue.
For government to be able to do anything, you need revenue. Not even government, even as individuals in our homes. If you don't have money, you can't do anything. So I don't want us to see this as NDC problem or NPP problem. This is a Ghana problem, and we must confront it. This is the biggest issue confronting this country in terms of economy, and we must resolve it. When we are able to solve it, it will solve most of the problems that we have in the country. Because if you have revenue, you can construct roads, you can build hospitals, you can build schools, you can feed your people. If you have money, you can build the bridges. If you have money, you can pay your debt. If you have money, you can do anything that you want to do. Now let's put this into context. When Ghana attained the middle income status, the ODA has been declining, meaning that the support that we get from IMF, World Bank, all these international organizations, has been declining because the attention is now being shifted to the poorer countries. Okay, so that's point one. Point two, we have borrowed so much. When we exited the HPIC initiative in 2006, Ghana's total public debt was 4.9 billion, let's say 5 billion. As we speak today, in 15 years, we have raised the public debt from 5 billion to 323 billion Ghana cedis. 23 billion Ghana cedis. In 15 years, we have raised the public debt from 5 to over 300 billion. So we had the opportunity to borrow, to invest, to change the structure of our economy. We have failed as Ghanaians that we're not able to borrow to change the structure of our economy. At this point, I'm not saying that government can be able to continue borrowing at this rate. Because when you continue to borrow, as we speak, our debt GDP ratio is over 70%. If you continue borrowing and piling up debt, you will get yourself into a debt distressed economy where nobody will mind you again. You go to the labor market, they are giving you over 20% interest rate because you are debt distressed. And IFS is saying that we don't want to get there. Hold we have seen me. The examples from Greece.
Hold on for
yes.
me.
Yes.
We heard the finance minister when he appeared before parliament to read the supplementary budget.
Yes.
Where he didn't ask for money.
Yes.
Said everything was on point. He was going to execute an agenda.
Yes.
So where is this coming from?
Borrowing. Borrowing. The fiscal deficit this year is 41 billion cedis. If your revenue is 72 billion and your expenditure is 113 billion, aren't you going to borrow? There are about six expenditure items in the budget, six.
Mm-hmm.
The first two, compensation for employees and interest payment, consume the entire revenue and grants of government, with about 20% still remaining to borrow. The third item, which is the earmarked fund, the statutory transfers to District Assembly Common Fund, Road Fund, GET Fund, NHIL, these are statutory transfers, and it's supposed to be a percentage of revenue. But now it is a percentage of loans. Because by the time we finish paying workers and pay interest rates, we have to borrow. So by the constitution, I'm not a lawyer, I'm sure the lawyers can look at this, but I don't want to cause any havoc here. I'm saying that by our fiscal understanding, the transfers to these units is supposed to be a percentage of revenue. As we speak, it is a percentage of borrowing.
What is the difficulty with raising the revenue? We've had this, we have this conversation every time the budget comes up. Domestic revenue mobilization. I think we've even had the World Bank rep or IMF rep talk about the need to up the ante when it comes to domestic revenue mobilization. What is the difficulty there? Because we've also had tax hikes, if I'm not mistaken, yeah. over the period.
Yeah.
And we're also told that half year, the domestic revenue mobilization had almost met its target, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah.
So where exactly is the problem with domestic revenue mobilization?
Let's get a picture first. Then we talk about what happened. Now, nominal revenue growth rate. I think you mentioned the figures, but let's put it into context.
Okay.
We've picked the first 4 years of government. So the last 4 years of President Kufuor, the 4 years of President Mills, and 4 years of President Mahama, and the 4 years of Nanado. It increased from 21.2% nominal. Mm. This is nominal revenue growth rate. Mm-hmm. Growth rate means like the speed with which revenue increases. 21.3% to 32.6%. That is President Mills' regime. 32.6%. Then President Mahama 19.9%. And then President Akufo-Addo 14.6%. Now, economists will always be interested in the real, because the real is the purchasing power. So what do? You take away inflation rate. When you take away inflation rate, these are the figures. For the last term of President Kufuor, 7.1%. President Mills, 18.7%. President Mahama, 3.8%. And President Akufo-Addo, 4%. If your real revenue is growing at 4%, this is not good for any economy that wants to transform. So what has happened? There were a number of taxes which were introduced, and there's this Laffer curve, which showed that by the time we got to the year 2014, these taxes were choking the economy, and they were supposed to have been abolished in the year 2014, which the MPP called the nuisance taxes, which they abolished and which we support. But the difficulty with the abolishment of these taxes is that we didn't have any contingency plan to replace the revenue that we lost. Mm-hmm. So when it comes to taxation, you know, let's spend some time on taxation. The tax multiplier effect on GDP is negative. So then why do we collect taxes? Government expenditure multiplier on GDP is positive. So you collect taxes, give it to government to spend so that it will stimulate the economic activity. That is why when you collect taxes and you give it to government, the government supplies it, then the GDP growth rate falls, because it will be negative, having negative effect on GDP. And again, you don't want to overtax the same people. Because if it's the same people who are paying taxes, last time I was listening to the deputy governor of the central bank saying less than 4 million Ghanaians pay income tax. As for VAT, and once you buy, you pay. So the indirect taxes, we all pay. But the income tax, even we have people evading and avoiding taxes, trying to estimate their profit just to run away from taxation. These are the issues. So the question you ask is the thesis for our research. Where did you go wrong, and how do we up our revenue collection? So we've gone wrong from a number of factors. Number one, this informal sector that we have been talking about. So before you do any research, you do literature review. Mm-hmm. So when we did a literature review about what has gone wrong with our revenue mobilization and what can be fixed. So first of all, the literature on informal sector, a research by SSB and Co. In this is 2016 figure. When government is able to tax the incomes of the people in the informal sector, it will be able to raise 227 million Ghana cedis every year. This is 2016 figure, so maybe 2021 it should be like 300 or 400 million.
Give or take.
Then property tax. The same research. Property tax is going to raise about 500 million Ghana cedis to government. Then tax exemptions. Tax exemption is going to raise 4.6 billion, not million, 4.6 billion cedis to government every year. Then, if we are looking at a budget deficit of 41 billion this year, and this one, the research was, we used figures for 2018 because we had to compare with developing countries and other countries, and you need current figures. So if you go to the IMF and the World Bank website, the current figures we had were up to 2018. So everything we are comparing, every figure I mentioned from now is up to 2018.
18, yes.
So by the 2018 figure, Ghana's revenue was about 4% shortfall from the African, the average for the African countries, and 7% shortfall for the average for developing countries. It means that if for every 100 cities that we should get in Africa, Ghana is able to raise like 70 or 80. We are not there yet in mm-hmm. terms of revenue. And therefore, we have resources, extractive sector, natural resources, because 227 from the informal sector, about 500 million from the property tax, 4.6 billion clearly is woefully inadequate to close the gap. So then IFF identified other sectors, and then we hit on the extractive sector. So here we divide the extractive sector into two: minerals and then oil. So when I say oil, it's oil and gas.
Gas, yeah.
So minerals and oil and gas. This is so interesting. I don't know if I can get a graph very soon. So we looked at why we are interested in the extractive sector. The extractive sector in Ghana commands The extractive sector in Ghana, we compared with 13 countries in the middle income, 21 countries in developing economies, because these are minerals and oil producing countries. So we just picked minerals and oil producing countries. Okay, current figure as of 2018. African economies of 11 African economies. The extractive sector as a ratio of GDP is the highest for Ghana. 13.6%, higher than middle-income countries of 13.4%, higher than all developing economies of 11.2%, and higher than all African economies of 8.4%. Now let's look at the extractive sector as a ratio of exports. Still, it is the highest in Ghana. Ghana's figure is of 67.7%, is the highest, higher than 66.1% for African economies, higher than 57.2% from all developing economies, and higher than 54.6% of middle-income economies. If you want to raise revenue, and all over the world, the extractive sector as a ratio of GDP, Ghana, you command the highest. And if you want to raise revenue, then it is a sector you must look at. But then somebody will say, then maybe we're already collecting enough. No. Mm-hmm. When the share of extractive sector as a ratio of total GDP is 13.6%, as a ratio of exports is about 67%, higher than the averages of all the other economies. Let's look at how much government is able to raise as revenue. Only 19.3%. What is happening to middle-income economies? 54.2%. What is happening to African economies? 50.9%. What is happening to all developing economies? 49.7%, about 50%. Ghana is only raising 19.3% revenue from the extractive sector's GDP. We have compared ourselves, our performance with that of Nigeria because of oil and that of Botswana because these are the best performing African economies when it comes to extractive sector, so minerals and then oil and gas. We didn't want to worry ourselves with Saudi Arabia and Norway because they are up there. We wanted to come to sub-Saharan Africa, and the best performance are Botswana in terms of minerals and Nigeria in terms of oil. Nigeria is able to raise 51.2% of their mineral rent. Mineral rent. When we say rent, it's profit, but economists define economic rent as, you know, all the cost plus opportunity cost of capital. So that's why the economist's profit will always be less than the accountant's profit, and we always fight when we meet. So economists will always add the opportunity cost of capital. So it means that this rent, for the past, you know, Ghana has been mining. I read the document from 2011 that gold and cocoa were the leading exports of our economy in 1911, 100 years down the line, gold and cocoa are still our leading exports, and we are not raising enough from this. We didn't want to even worry ourselves with the years before, so we picked data from just 10 years ago because Ghana started recording the production of oil in commercial quantities in 2011. So just 10 years ago, the economic rent to the extractive sector in Ghana, $43
billion. $43
billion? Yes. The economic rent. So in this
economic
case,
rent, what does it mean?
Economic rent means your sales, your revenue minus all cost minus opportunity cost of capital. So if you ask an investor to bring something, you know, maybe let's say CCTV or machines belongs to Franklin in USA, and he says, I'm bringing my camera and mine for you, but I could have used it in, say, USA for this show. So we calculate the alternative use of that, and we deduct it. So the investor wouldn't lose. So it means that if it was an accountant doing the calculation, the accountant would have gotten higher figure. $43 billion in Ghana raised from the extractive sector. This is profit going to the investors. It's not coming to Ghana government. How much is Ghana government getting? Only 10.4%.
So something, that dynamic needs to change.
Yes. So the conclusion is that if you compare ourselves with in terms of the minerals, the best performing practices of Botswana, we will raise $13 billion additional revenue, $13 billion. If we do the best practices of Botswana, and we can go into details, but you know, we don't have time. So, yeah. If we perform like Botswana,
$13 billion
per the 2018 figure. So it means 2021, we should be talking about some 15 billion cedis.
Cedis.
Annually.
Yeah.
This is the year, just 1 year. Cedis 1 year. Then for the oil, if we perform better as Nigeria is performing, we'll be able to raise about 7 billion. Put together, 20 billion. If we are able to perform better like Nigeria in terms of oil and Botswana in terms of the minerals, Ghana government is able to raise 20 billion cedis a year per the 2018 figure.
Okay, so Edu, in 30 seconds, explain this to me, to everybody like a layman. What is the difficulty in being able to do this?
We have natural resources in our own soil. It's supposed to be a national asset. We are not treating it as a national asset. We have given the national asset in the hands of the private person, and the private person is using it for his own gains, and what Ghana government is getting is just royalties and taxes.
Okay, hold on for me. Sticker. Anna Steven Amwa. Please unmute your microphone.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, I can hear you. Thank you very much. I'm sure you've heard Dr. Edu Osusa Akodie and his analysis of the potential the economy has if particularly we pay attention to the extractive sector, and also the dire picture that is painted based on just how much we are borrowing and what it means for the economy. Your thoughts. Is that an assertion you agree with?
I am quite surprised. You see,
please position your camera well for me, if you can, please.
Can you see me now?
Yes, it's okay.
I am surprised because my brother said that he said that he picked the fiscal aspect of our economy in terms of appraising its performance. There's nothing wrong with that. But he knows perfectly well that when it comes to these fiscal issues, major parameters are one, our revenue, our expenditure, and then our financing options. The financing option definitely would be either our revenue or even our debt. And we know perfectly well that, in fact, from latter part of 2019 or 2020 to beginning of 2020, I stand to be corrected with the time, up to now, the COVID economy, whether you like it or not, impaired our productivity as a country. Let's be very real. Let's be practical and honest in discharging our professional stewardship. And because productivity has been impaired, it has affected trading operations or activities and industrial operations in Ghana. And uncontrollably, it has affected our revenue generation. And once revenue generation is one of the financing arms in any country has been affected, government, because of our inability to not to perform some of the strategic obligations, will have to borrow. And because the productivity was also impaired, it did not go on with the needed or corresponding GDP growth. So uncontrollably, there will be debt to GDP growth going up. This one, I'm sure he's better than me in economics, but this anywhere in the world will happen. Then let me come in.
Please go on.
If you're talking about debt, here it's not his. I'm not talking about him. If you're talking about debt, boss, between the year 2000 that he quoted, that our debt portfolio in 2009 was somewhere around, or it was about 9.3 thereabout.
So he did. Let me just give you the numbers. So he gave us from 2006 when we exited HIPIC, we were at 4.6 billion.
No, I'm coming.
I'm just giving you the numbers now,
I'll get you.
Okay.
I'll get you, but I want to continue.
Okay.
From 2009, we had about 9.3 billion. And our debt to GDP was somewhere around 32%. In fact, I'm away from home, so I'm not having the figures from me, but at least I can remember most of these.
I'll grant
you that. Between 2009 up to 2016, we increased our debt portfolio over 1,000%, from 9.3 to about 120 billion. If you check, even between 2016 and 2020, our debt portfolio has been increased by about 144%. Between 2012 to 2016, our debt portfolio was increased by about 240%. We were not having situations such as HIPIC. In fact, the PFM Act 2016 Act 921 Section 18 states emphatically three conditions under which any our fiscal rules and policies upon consultation and approval from, I think, is it cabinet or whatever, or council or whatever, has to be even suspended. So what I'm saying is that any analysis or with our fiscal performance will not even, in my opinion, be fair, because the situations in which we have found ourselves in have been so bad. But I agree with him when it comes to Ghana as a whole, for whether NDC or MPP, over the years, there are certain basic things we've not done right. That probably some of these shocks, we cannot contain them. And if you talk about Nigeria's oil performance and Ghana's oil performance, they discovered oil in 1956. In terms of experience, when did we discover oil? Yes, I agree with him. If domestically we have control over our own oil, we wouldn't have suffered the way we are suffering. But the economy to even discover the oil in quantity, what goes into it in terms of engineering, in terms of procurement of gadgets and techniques that we need, Ghana did not have the capacity. Let's be honest. So what I'm trying to say is that even though what he's saying is a fact, I think he has to make sure that he presents it in a way that people will appreciate the reality of it. Because at the end of the day, if productivity is not going on, he can't tell me that it will not affect our revenue. If our revenue uncontrollably is not being gotten the way, of course, even without the COVID, we are having issues with revenue generation, leakages. They talk about widening the net before I was born. Tell me whether NDC or MPP or any economist in Ghana can tell you that if we widen the tax, we'll get extra $12 billion and that could solve our problems. And that's a problem I have in Ghana. You see, there are certain areas in Ghana. Just give me just one second. I want Ghanaians to understand today, I beg you just one second because of earlier statement. Understand today that if you see a politician driving a car, whether Land Cruiser or not, it's not all the time that it's something you got to do with politics. Me, I am in politics, but if you go to Kwa West, I have the largest palm plantation. I produce palm oil on the market, certified by FDA. I have my company almost 20 years. I've worked outside before and here, no matter the level of work. So sometimes that perception, with respect to what my sister said before he left, anyway, just by the way, I think Ghanaians rush into criticizing factors that they have not analyzed deeply and come out with what it is. Or they do one side and they leave the other side. And I'm also surprised that why is the IIF, or is it IMS, picked only the fiscal aspect? Because you need to do things and tackle the economy as a whole. 2016, what was the situation like in terms of interest rate? Interest rate is extremely important, very critical in day-to-day running of any economy such as we're having. It was almost 40%, 37, 38. Now, interest rate, you can get some below 21%. T-bills, which we know have strong correlation inversely to our economic performance, has been reduced drastically. Policy rate, even the inflationary rate, even with the GDP, the World Bank, or is it IMF or World Bank, they predicted negative 3.3. Global growth. Ghana grew 0.4 to about 0.9. So things are not good economically, I agree, because it is a century-old problem with our socioeconomic infrastructure and the management of it. That one I agree. But you can't pick fiscal aspect of it. The time that you know we have a situation such as health epidemic, which is one of the conditions in the PFM Act, which even calls for suspension of our fiscal rules and policies. If you do that to me, you're not being fair. That is my issue. You're not being fair. Why didn't you pick all these things and speak to them? If you're also talking about, progress or growth or otherwise of parameters, I would have expected them to give, reference point analysis with respect to time, some sort of regression analysis, and bring the output for people to know that at least, yes, things are this, but from this stage to this stage, this stage to this stage, this stage to this stage, it's still bad. We need to do ABC. You need to pick all the aspects that will affect our GDP, because you know GDP cannot grow when productivity is low. Because the two main functions of long-term growth of any economy, which of course is the GDP I'm talking about, is productivity and labor. Because of COVID, the labor size in our country was downsized, especially in the private sector, not the public sector. That affected our GDP growth and performance, and it's an uncontrollable factor. So we need to make sure that all these issues must be well addressed. The banking sector, for the first time, by 2019 from 2016, had increased profitability over 140%. I stand to be corrected. Hitherto, it was just dying. It was a dying industry. And it's very instrumental in managing, in fact, it's the health of every economy in any jurisdiction. So if you want to analyze the performance of the economy, all these parameters must be considered. You can't just go and pick one area that because of probably, I would say, natural disaster, health epidemic, which has seized our productivity and other things, they are not doing well and say that the economy is whatever it is. In fact, the board, is it the board of IMF? Their summary sheet, go and read, that they attributed the performance of our economy to the COVID and said that they realized that it has a future because things being done right now shows that the economy can pick up. So what do we say about that? So the IMF said then, I'm not against it, but I'm surprised that they picked one aspect. I'm also surprised that they did not bring the very reasons that have caused the underperformance of some of the variables leading to public debt to GDP and the GDP performance itself. That's the problem I have with this.
Okay, hold on with that problem for me. I'll go to Dr. Asakodie again before I come to Franklin and Sunis. Okay. Please allow me, if you don't mind. Yes. All right, Dr. Asakodie.
But well,
he has raised a couple of questions.
Yes.
I think he says your assessment of the economy does not take into account context, and you need to paint that picture properly for people, which I think is a fair comment.
Yeah.
And then also says, if you paint the context properly, then perhaps it gives greater understanding to the problems of the economy.
Yeah.
And so you will not maybe give them as much grief as you are now.
After our research, one of the recommendations that we made that the implementation of our recommendation should be devoid of partisanship. This was my first comment. And I am not happy that he used the word dishonest on my presentations, but I mean, I will forgive
him. Okay.
Sorry, I'm very sorry. Please forgive me. I didn't mean that.
I only said,
yeah, I'm sorry.
The latest figures that we got were from 2018. This was before the COVID. I was even the first economist to have advised government.
What was the GDP growth?
He will answer your questions.
What was the GDP growth the year 2019? He should tell us then. That
okay,
was
no
about
problem.
Seven. Averagely from 2016 to 2019 before the COVID, averagely was about 7.
Yes.
It was about 7. So why can't we say that the COVID had impact on that?
Okay. Just let him go through, and then I come back to you. I normally don't just like people speaking across each other.
From 3.4.
Just wait for me. I'm just giving you 15 minutes. Allow him to respond.
This research was on revenue generation.
Yes.
How do we get the best from the extractive sector? IFS has been publishing papers. I mean, sometimes we pick earmarked funds, we pick macroeconomic stability. We have been praising governments over the years, both NDC and MPP, for maintaining macroeconomic stability, low inflation, low interest rate, low policy rate. These are good indicators for every economy to attract investment, which is good. We also understand that COVID has serious effects on our economy. We haven't disputed that. And even I was saying that I was one of the first economists who even recommended that government should borrow to spend to stimulate the economy. The Great Depression 1929 showed us that in times of difficulties, you borrow to spend bailout. In 2008 financial crisis, it indicates that in times of economic slowdown, government should borrow and spend. So COVID has had devastating effect on our economy. But during COVID, gold prices increased. Ghana exported $6 billion worth of gold last year in COVID. We are talking about minerals. Gold. Ghana is the fourth largest producer of gold in the world. Ghana is the first largest producer of gold in Africa. And we are talking about a commodity whose price has increased during COVID. And all we are saying is that, yes, COVID has had negative effect on us, but there are other items that are doing well, which we don't get enough revenue from. And we have touched on the minerals. Number one is the gold. Gold prices has increased in COVID. If you export $6 billion worth of
gold,
we haven't even touched on the other minerals that we produce in Ghana, bauxite and all that. Ghana earned just around $600 to $700 million, dollars from that. Let's do some calculations. Last year, the average oil price was around $43 per barrel. Ghana exported 66.9 million barrels. If you do the math, you're talking about some $2.9 billion. Ask me how much government got as a revenue in the budget.
How much?
670 million. So let's say 700 million. The remaining 2.2, where did it go? The remaining $2.2 billion economic rent, it went to the mining companies. This is the issue that we are talking about, that we need to raise revenue. So let me come to so honorable, macroeconomic stability, we have, you know, commended the government for doing it. It's a fantastic idea. We are talking about revenue generation. We wanted to compare ourselves with economies around the world, and of course you can't get current figures from Bank of Ghana and from World Bank and IMF 2021. So we picked the 20. This research was even done last year. So we have to finalize it this year and do the presentation. So while you're doing research, the time is always made. I've made reference to you that any figure that I mentioned is 2018. And we compared ourselves in 2018 without COVID. In 2018, we were spending 99% of our revenue on just two items in 2018. The interest payment as a ratio of revenue was 33.4% in 2018 without COVID. It's the highest. You see, that's why all this we're having mentioned debt to GDP ratio, because you can just rebase your GDP and everything will fall. That is why we are talking about revenue, because you can run to IMF to borrow. You can run to the Eurobond market to borrow. When you come back home, you will need the revenue that you generate to service your debt. You know why I don't want to use debt to GDP ratio? Because Ghana's debt to GDP ratio in 2018, I think it was around 55% or so, at 56.1% in 2018. Japan, 232%. Italy, 134%. Portugal, 121%. United Kingdom, 85%. Ghana, 56%. This is debt to GDP ratio. But what is the interest payment as a ratio of revenue? This is where the issue is.
Okay.
Ghana, 33%, the highest. Japan, 11%. Italy, 9%. Portugal, 8%. United Kingdom, 6.9%. This is the fact. We are not talking about debt to GDP ratio. I will not do my fiscal analysis and stick to debt to GDP ratio, because it's not a fair, it doesn't give us a fair indication of what is happening. The debt service is important. The interest payment you pay is important. The revenue generation of this country is so poor, and we have realized that the gap is so huge that if you talk, only few amount will be raised from the informal sector, about 300 million, property tax, 500 million, tax exemptions, 4.6 billion. This year alone, we are talking about a gap of 41 billion. And IFS is saying that if 2018 figures indicated that if we perform like Nigeria and Botswana, we could raise 20 billion additional. 20 billion additional, that is what we are talking about. He mentioned that Nigeria has been producing oil for a long time. We are not disputing that. That is why IFS is starting the debate. Franklin is here. Honorable, you are here. Media, you are here. We are starting the debate now. We have sat down as a country. We have allowed $43 billion worth of economic rent to go into somebody's hands in 10 years. We cannot continue this. If Ghana was able to get half of that is $20 billion, we will not go to the Eurobond market to borrow, because all the Eurobond markets, all the Eurobonds that we have raised in the market amount to about $15 billion. So even if we were performing better as Nigeria and Botswana, we will not need to go to the Eurobond market again.
Your point is well made. Honorable Amoah, I take note of your request to ask a question, but I need to hear from Honorable Suhini and Franklin before I get to you on that. So, Honorable Suhini, please, the microphone is yours.
Well, sometimes...
You have 10 minutes.
Those ticker got 15.
Yes.
Anyway. Sometimes I think that we bastardize politics too much in this country. And it doesn't help our progress. Because of that, some of the things, some of the reality of our situation dawns on us belatedly. Why do I say this? It is as if when people join politics, all of a sudden they lose their professionalism. So it doesn't matter if you are a professional doctor. It doesn't matter if you are a professional accountant. It doesn't matter if you are a professional economist. Once you stand elections or you get appointed, into politics, everything you say is now viewed with a political lens. I say this because almost everything that is being found by IFS, the IMF, and other agencies that is cause for this discussion have been raised severally by the minority in parliament. So I see this as vindication. Look, go and read Dr. Atufosun's recent presentation when we had our minority dialogue series. He pointed out the debt service ratio to GDP and said it was the major threat to our growth as a country and how bad it was, and compared it, just as IFS has done, to other countries. And Ghana came out worse in terms of, you know, our ability to service our debts. He did. It's there. You can go and look at it. Now, IFS concluded on three major things, and I'll touch on them if you give me the time. One, they talked about government revenue declining, which is a problem. They talked about serious expenditure management as a problem. And they also talked about extra budgetary fiscal activities. So let's start with one. Government's revenue being a problem. Again, this is so disappointing because this was a government that had the biggest opportunity, you know, to increase our revenue. I mean, the ground work had been done and they had so much going for it. For example, expansion at our ports, you know, the increase in oil wells from 1 to 3, handed over to them. They had that opportunity. Again, despite all of that, this government then went into a contract with McKinsey Group of Nigeria, paying them $20 million to help GRA to increase tax revenue by about 17%. They failed, yet they got paid. That's the, you know, sad part of this whole discussion. They had so much going for them that they did not take advantage of, came up with, you know, what was supposed to be a brilliant idea of getting an agency to help the Ghana Revenue Authority, which ended up rather taking away hard-earned, you know, revenue from the government without adding anything. And we raised those issues. For example, Godfrey, if you look at the domestic revenue performance, from 2013 to 2016, domestic revenue was about 13.3% of GDP. Averagely. From 2017 to 2020, it's been 12% to GDP. Again, this was in the presentation of Honorable Isaac Adongo, when he, together with Atufosun, again held a, you know, town hall meeting, I think about a year or so ago, and highlighted the fact that we needed to do something about, you know, how badly we're doing in terms of revenue mobilization. But again, it was considered politics, and so attention was not really paid to that. The question is, how did we get here? Populists in some cases and propagandist, you know, policies is what has led us partly to this place. I agree with, you know, how much we can get. For example, if we retool and refine our contract arrangements with how we allocate oil wells and how we, you know, get, you know, investors into the oil sector. I agree with that. But you cannot also discount the effect on the situation that we have currently, where revenue is low, on those populist and propaganda decisions of this government that, again, as a minority in parliament, we raise issues with. We'll be discussing the next topic about benchmark values at the ports.
You can mix it up if you want right now.
You understand? Yes. I mean, I recall when they came up with that policy. What did we say as a minority? In fact, I recall Honorable John Jinapo said that this government was not seeing governance as a serious business. I'll just share with you. He said, NPP yet to realize government is a serious business.
Because of that decision?
Because that decision was not well thought through. That is why we are having to discuss it today. It was not well thought through. One, it has not led to reduction in prices of goods in this country. In fact, when you go to the market, these days, the prices increase weekly. Cement that was about 34 is now about 54. You go
likely
still
to hit 60. We are told.
Look, everything is going up. What was the purpose of that, you know, decision? The production sector is also suffering. We made all these observations that, I mean, governance is a serious business. You just don't play politics with it. Today, the chicken is coming home to roost. You cannot dismiss those, you know, populist and, you know, propaganda decisions of this government when it comes to, you know, the problem of low revenue in this country. And
but wouldn't you say that's a bit of an unfair categorization, considering that there was a delegation from the import community who went to the government and said, look, there's a genuine struggle at the ports. Can you help us with this?
The problems at the port was not only limited to those benchmark values. Even though they are reduced, there are still problems at the port affecting, you know, importation, affecting business in general. So that is why, again, I agree with Jinapo when he says that governance should be seen as a more serious business than this government is doing. I mean, so yes, that is for the first part, the government's revenue decline. We cannot, you know, absolve this government from blame when it comes to the fact that we are doing poorly in terms of revenue mobilization, when we had everything going for us, especially this government, to have done better. Because under the previous administration, we're doing, like I said, more 13.3% domestic revenue, not even tax or oil revenue. We're just domestic revenue. So why are we where we are? I'm saying it's because of some of these reckless decisions. Then again, too, they talked about serious expenditure management. We have just finished discussing the issue of corruption as our first topic, mm-hmm. where the perception is that it's on the ascendancy. It has increased. The Transparency International has confirmed it, mm-hmm. that we are losing so much of even the revenue, the little revenue generated, to corruption. Again, those are issues we have raised as a minority, but it is politics. You come to look at a very important point they make in their findings. They say, quote, a major and worrying consequence of this fiscal situation is falling government investment spending, which will undermine the country's long-term economic growth and development. Again, as a minority, we have said this in various forms, like Chop Chop. You remember the issue of Chop Chop?
Mm-hmm.
The mismanagement, the investments that this government has been doing has not been targeted at investments that will bring about growth in the economy. We have complained about where the investment is going. For example, when you look at investment expenditure, from 2012 to 2016, the records show that President Mahama inherited investment expenditure at about 19%. And by 2016, it was around 26.1%. So between 2012 and 2016, it went from 19% to 26.1%. Now, what has this government done? In 2017, they did 16%. In 2018, they did 9.9% investment. In 2019, they did 11.5%. Guess what? In an election year where they knew that they had to point to some level of infrastructure. So it is not as if they don't know that it is the most important investment to make. It is just because they don't care. They only do when they are faced with an election. So in 2020, they increased it to 21%. It has come down again to about 16% because elections are over. So the area in which we even, you know, spend is also a serious issue. And that is why President Nkrumah described some of these investments in the past as, you know, assets, investments. And his opponents called it debts. John Mahama described them as assets. His opponents called it debts. Interestingly, however, those who call those things debts came. They are not doing those level of investments, but they have increased our debt stock. President Mahama inherited it at 42.6% of GDP, left it at 55.6% of GDP. I'm talking about debt. Mm. Those who called it debt and have come and are not doing the same level of investments have increased our debt from 55.6% to 76%. That's us twice as President Mahama was doing. Yet the investment, you know, in the sectors that will actually help grow the economy has gone down. Lastly, the third point they make, extra budgetary fiscal activities. Again, this is an area we have sung a lot about as a minority, the massaging of the numbers. As a minority, Honorable Isaac Adongo, whether Jinnah Paul, whether Atuforsen, have all talked about the massaging of the figures. And Godfrey, you can refer to the IMF July release, where they also finally make this, you know, admission of the numbers not adding up. For example, they say on page 10 that higher than projected contingent liabilities could further worsen the debt outlook. Energy and financial sector cleanup costs added 7% GDP to public debt over the past 3 years. Higher than expected costs from these sectors, but also materialization of liabilities in the SOEs sector could burden public finances in the medium term and increase public debt. We have talked about the collateralization at GetFund, for example, mm-hmm. and how all of those remain a threat to this debt, you know, that we are building up that we may not be able.
Your time is up, Sahidi. Your time is up, Sahidi. I'll take a quick break. We'll come back. We hear from Franklin Cudjoe on this matter and then wrap up the conversation on the
week. I'm not like sticker, so I'll
And the Philly Abacum will be a account of the Bimonti. So you see ADTV and then you say, look at journalism now. So, yeah, AD. So, person will collect pictures. Now, try the only bedroom idea. And then I could watch it HD plus decoder. And then I'll share. But we'll be a clear and you feel Philly. Wow, I'm talking about the crowd.
HD logo the bottom. Where you say HD local channels na mo hello. As a picture see clear. And your 5 times better. As in other channels that could be your hormone. So the mention some in terms of
your way. Oh, what a pictures.
Could you HD plus decoder or multi TV and now natural agent PR natural local channels na HD HD plus decoder be a button. You have 2 months free subscription. The hearing is all better.
*879#
Numbers from Kubiwa box, and now the advert. AD, channels leading in. Look at me.
Wow, mommy, I want clear pictures like this for my kids' channel.
Welcome back to the big issue. Franklin, you've heard the academic, you've heard the politicians.
Yes. So everything I said is
no, that's not what I said. Academic. I said you've heard the academic. He's an academic, a politician, are you not? Even though these days you dabble in both.
You know, you underestimate the impact of think tanks at your own peril. I'm quite happy that the political class has started picking up these types of learnings. In spite of the fact that they also have stalwarts within themselves, within the political parties. But I think you can only have undiluted conversations like the ones the IFS put together. And it's important that we keep encouraging these type of conversations. Because the matters concerning our public finances are for everyone to basically judge, or there are experts who look at these numbers and then advise you. That's not to say that, as Honorable Sini said, most of these things haven't been said in the past. I think IFS's work brings to the fore the rather crucial, if not dire, situation that we have in the country right now. And I think it's important that we acknowledge these efforts as part of our nation-building agenda. You know, I wondered when the current government promised that they were going to move away from taxation to production, as to whether they've done the permutations properly. That's not to say that I like taxes. In fact, I'm a libertarian, and libertarians believe in minimal taxes as long as you have very competent alternatives outside government. But I thought that they probably had not done their homework quite well. So some of the raft of taxes they took away, and admittedly some of them were quite prohibitive in terms of encouraging businesses. But if the iterations have been done in such a way as Dr. Sarkodie and the IFS present, that even at the barest minimum, the traditional sources of funding or financing the government themselves have not been exhausted, and that a lot of work have not been done properly, and that there are a lot of economic rents, and I dare say political rents as well, then somehow would have been able to have our problems. It's important. I mean, he mentions the issues of exemptions. I see exemptions as it's critical that the economy that professes to be market friendly should give some investors the opportunity to come in. But at the same time, it must be done in such a way that they are not chronic capitalist arrangements. They are not just freebies given without any proper exactions from the various companies. So a lot of questions have been asked about exemptions, and I think it's important that the figure has now grown per the study Dr. Sarkodie cited, that exemptions, if looked at properly, looks as if you are getting close to, did you say 8 billion?
4.6 billion.
Dollars?
No, cedis.
Oh, cedis. Okay. Yes, yes. I think 2017 it was around 2.2 billion cedis.
Yeah, now it's
so now
increased.
Yes. It's almost gone, doubled. It's almost doubled. And I think it's important that we have that conversation as to what benefits the economy gets when we exert or when we give these concessions. Because somehow it's supposed to be a multiplier effect on the economy. Somehow you entice people to come into your economy. But if you haven't done the iterations in such a way that you ask yourself, what other benefits am I getting when I give these assumptions? When I look at the free zones, is it all really free zones? That those who come in and operate there claim they employ a number of people, but in actual fact, they ship almost everything away and make monumental profits at the disadvantage of the country. This must all be looked into. I tend to ask myself, what is it that would motivate everybody to pay a tax in the country, however informal the activities really are? I guess it's also the question about what people are expecting from government. What do they see in return? But I also think that it's important to have done a proper analysis of the productivity of each district or each municipality in this country, so that when we want to talk about decentralization, not just political decentralization, but also fiscal decentralization, so that we begin to ask ourselves, is it possible to multiply, actually increase our property taxation? I mean, he references a colleague's work as well as being able to gain almost 500 million cedis per his own estimation. I think it's even more than that, because as we know, only 10% of Accra lands have been digitized, which means only 10% of Ghanaian lands have been digitized, because the rest of the country is in, everybody is doing whatever they want. And these have been corroborated by the Lands Commission, by the way. So that if there was effective decentralization fiscally as well, what it meant was that municipalities would have been given the power and had the authority to do proper valuation, quantification of these assets. And then they wouldn't even have to give themselves any benchmarks. Your development, 80% depends on what you are able to generate. So you begin to then find out basically ideas as to how you can maximize the revenues from the various decentralized units. But I think that it's important to also look at the, I mean, I see the added benefits in looking at what exists already, the traditional sources of finance. And I like the conversations about the natural resources. There's a lot that goes out as well, which is not accounted for. I'm sure you remember the gold exports that were reported some time back. I think Switzerland reported that, look, they know the type, the amount of gold they took from Ghana, but in actual fact, it was 7 billion or something short when we compare that with what official receipts were reported from Ghana. But a part of me also feels that we also need to start looking at the new economy. I mean, what is the end goal of our education if we are not taking advantage of the new economy? So that traditional sources should be exploited and they should add value. But it looks to me that the new economy, in terms of the services, financial services, the technology services that are supposed to be generated from the new economy, can also be a source of significant wealth for a country. But you cannot have this conversation again without looking at the places that generate some of the significant amounts of revenue so far, the ports. And while I like the conversation about benchmark values, again, you get into this chicken and egg situation where benchmark values, if revised, are supposed to help a productive economy. But if not done properly, you see some of the rent-seeking approaches or activities that you see you are reported. But I worry because the collusive and the criminality that occurs at our ports must also be looked into. But we are yet to publish a report we conducted over a year and a half ago about the state of our thermal ports and some of the things we found in terms of the state of organized crime that exists at our ports, leading to basically hemorrhaging of revenue, is a very serious problem. So importers and exporters may as well be crying over the issues of benchmark values. But I think it's a collusive enterprise which needs to be looked at if we are looking at trying to unburden the Ghanaian from paying income taxes or the little that they contribute by way of taxes, when we should be looking at these, what I call, I wouldn't like to use the word nation records, but essentially collusive elements at the highest levels. Which is why I think that we should also start looking at solutions to the way we handle our warehouses, our logistics hub, and all of that arrangement. Because warehouses have become a source of these hemorrhaging as well. You know, goods are brought into warehouses and they're supposed to be electronically tagged, but not much is seen. And I think we need to start moving into how the countries that are highly effective have managed their warehousing facilities. I may not be giving too much away, but I think it is important to look at the ports critically. And any fair-minded person who wants to revolutionize our revenue regime, as long as our tax, our exports, our imports are concerned, we need to start looking at that. And finally, I'd like to just make the point about waste. You know, again, the IFS report points to maybe extra fiscal activities, which I think they give, just give a nice name to. But in actual fact, they also mean a lot of waste, which is where we would have to come back to the conversations about partnerships for development.
Mm.
Alhaji Suyini references the term he used about the some of the nature of these political promises, which are tend to be sloganeering, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's important that in order to step back from sloganeering-oriented development projects, which are usually at the behest of the central command of government, which are largely wasteful and not productive, I think it's important to start asking questions. Okay. Even prisons could be built by the private sector, as far as they'll be managed.
All right, then. Thank you very
There's
much.
There's a lot that ought to be done in the road sector, and most sectors, and it should be done on a fair basis so that we don't lose revenue, as the IFS and Dr. Sarkodie have amplified.
All right. Thank you very much, Franklin Kujan. Dr. Sarkodie, we'll find time again to continue this conversation.
Yes.
But for today, we have run out of time. Big thank you to the Member of Parliament for Nshaiso, Stephen Amwa, Franklin Kujan, President of Imani Africa, Lassan Suhini, Member of Parliament for Tamale North. A big thank you as well to Mavis Zupok Dome, who joined us from the CDD, the first part of our conversation. I hope you enjoyed the program. My name is Godfrey Akotobuafo. Have a good weekend.